glad everybody's here. Y'all glad you're here? All right. 10% of you's glad you're here, but that's okay. Let's all stand up this morning. Let's lift our voices together. Christ is all.
It is good to see everyone this morning. We're grateful that you're here to spend this time in worship with us today at High Point. And if you are visiting with us today, we're also very excited to have you with us to be a part of our service today. If you are visiting, there are some guest information cards in the pews in front of you. And we would encourage you just to simply pick one of those up and fill that information out so we can get to know you just a little bit better. A couple of announcements I do need to call your attention to today, and here they go. One tonight at 5:30. Also, we're having our services tonight, and we're having business meeting, which was delayed a week because I couldn't be here last Sunday evening. Then on Tuesday, and this is a correction in the bulletin because it says it's on Wednesday, the Hispanic Bible study is at 6 o'clock on Tuesdays, so keep that in mind. That's just a misprint in the bulletin. And then on Wednesday, we have Cool Kids at 6 and also a prayer meeting going on at 6 o'clock as well. Also, an announcement for today. There will be a meeting immediately following our service today regarding the Extension Department. And if anyone is interested in helping with the homebound ministry here at High Point, we would like you to come and to be a part of that. And where are they going to meet, Kent? Right in the front up here somewhere. So that's the best way to gather with people and do that. So if you have any interest in being engaged and involved in the homebound ministry, we pray you'll just stick around and be a part of that as well. Also, Trunk or Treat is coming up on the first day of November, and it'll be from 5 to 7. Also, you need to go ahead and sign up for chili and for using your car for part of that thing that goes on that day. And if you desire to drop candy by to be a part of that, you can be doing that now. And most of the time, the staff is usually really preferential on the kind of candy they like to have dropped by, you know, because sometimes they really prefer Hershey bars and, you know, something really good besides. You know, there's some candy that some people don't really like at all. I know it's all real cheap at the stores, but sometimes we like the good candy. So we joke about candy, but whatever candy you can bring, I know they'll appreciate getting it. And somebody somewhere, I'm sure, will consume it along the way. Keep in mind, they're still signing up to go to the concert with Toby Mac and Zach Williams in Evansville later on, on the fifth day of November. So keep that in mind. Also, there's going to be, on November the 11th, a women's brunch, and the sign-up sheet is available for that at the present time as well. So you can go ahead and sign up for that. That wasn't up until, I believe, today. Also, Operation Christmas Child is in the process of getting kicked off and going, so you can either pick up your shoeboxes or you can start making donations to help get everything taken care of for that. You'll also note a couple of key thank yous that are listed for us in the bulletin today. For some folks who have gone the second mile and helping change out lights and do a host of other projects. Seems like every time I slide by the church, there's somebody here working on something. And for all those things that need to get taken care of, we've always been grateful for the folks with a volunteer spirit who love to help out and do those kinds of things. Today, our scripture reading is going to be taken from Psalm 91 and verses 1 and 2. A very, very familiar passage of Scripture for us today. And it goes, "Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say, the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." Let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Father, we are so grateful that You are our refuge, that You are the one we can turn to in the midst of the difficulties of this life. And Father, we know it's not just about turning to You during the difficulties of this life, but being turned in Your direction at all times. Father, there are so many challenges that face us in our world at the present time. Lord, I know closer to home we have the challenges that are just involved with sometimes making ends meet. We're battling health issues and health problems. We have relational issues that go on, problems where we work. Lord, other kind of challenges are always present. And we're grateful that You're with us every step of the way as we find ourselves going through those times. And I realize the folks here at High Point, Lord, being a believer doesn't make you immune from going through times of difficulty and hardship. We realize that times of suffering and hardship are just a part of life. And sometimes the worst part for us, Father, is waiting. But it's in the midst of the waiting, and it's in the midst of going through those times that we learn a deeper, more abiding level of trust and faith in You. And so, Father, I pray in the midst of all that goes on, You would continue to give us the patience that we need, and that You would give us the encouragement and the strength that we need to continue to step forward and move in Your direction. And then, Father, we are so mindful as well of the problems that are going on in our world. Lord, over the past 7 or 8 days now, our attention has really been focused on the Middle East. And we've always known, Father, that whole area is just a powder keg just waiting to go off. But, Father, as we have witnessed what we witnessed in Israel and now the retaliation that's going on and taking place, we realize there's countless families whose lives have been changed forever because of what's happened and what's taken place. We know there's a great need for comfort. There's also a great need for healing on the part of many, many people. And we realize, Father, that there's a deep-seated mistrust between the peoples that are there. Father, being believers in you, we believe you are the Prince of Peace. And we know the majority of the people there don't believe in you. They believe either in the God of just the Old Testament or Allah. And Father, unfortunately, there seems to be no common ground between them at all. Father, we realize your Son is the great mediator, and he's the only one that can bring lasting peace. And Father, even when they're not firing missiles and rockets and guns at each other over there, we know there's really not any peace. And Father, there's so much hatred and so much animosity. Father, for that reason, we simply pray, Lord, for your will to be worked out. And Father, when we think about everybody trying to pick sides and line up over there, it sure does look an awful lot like some Old Testament prophecies about how the end can come down. And so, Father, we know you're in charge. We know at times for us, here it doesn't look like it, but Father, we've come to know and to acknowledge that you are in charge and that you are leading and moving this world in a direction you want it to go. And Father, the key thing for us to do is to turn our hearts totally and completely to you. We're not to live in fear. We're not to cower down. We're to be people who trust you implicitly, knowing that you're going to see us through to the end. Thank you for the hope that is ours in you. You are our refuge and our fortress. You are the God in whom we trust. And for that reason, Father, we have hope, we have strength, we have encouragement, and we have your power today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's all stand together again. He will hold me fast. When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my home through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Those he saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast, precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by him at such a cost, he will hold me fast. Yeah. justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast, raised with him to endless life. He will hold me fast till our faith is turned to sight, when he comes at last. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. My Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast. Hymn number 15, Come Thou Fount of Ever Blessing. Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise is how deep the Father's love for us. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, chosen one, bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything.
thank you for this day. Thank you for the freedom that we're allowed to meet here. We ask that you be with every undertaking of our church. Please be with Brother Don today as he brings your message. Please help him. Please be with all those that are sick, those that are in the nursing homes and in the hospitals, and those that are confined to their homes. Thank you for each blessing you give us, Lord. And please forgive us for our sins. These things we ask in Jesus' name.
Last Sunday, we found ourselves in the 8th chapter of 2 Corinthians, and today we'll find ourselves just the next chapter over, the 9th chapter. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, I'll read the whole chapter in just a moment or two, but just to set the stage, we talked last Sunday for a few minutes about giving, and we're going to talk today and finish it up as we find ourselves looking at what Paul had to say to the church at Corinth about something that was going on. Last week, if you'll remember, if you were here last week in the 8th chapter, they were commended to begin with for following the pattern of Christ and giving sacrificially. They were also, one of the things that really stood out is that they really had this eager willingness and desire to give. And so we spent a few moments talking about that as well. And so what happens is, as he laid this out in the 8th chapter, and then he sends Titus to help inspire them to finish up, he finally carries it to the 9th chapter, and part of this is a little repetitious, but why do things get repeated anyway? So we can remember, right? You know, when you hear something once, you hear it once. When you hear something twice, you go, okay. But if you hear something the third time, what does that usually mean? God's really wanting you to do something, right? It's sort of like if you're having your quiet time in the morning and you read about loving something or someone, and then a little while later, you got the radio on, and there's a song about loving somebody that, you know, is sort of hard to love. And then a little bit later on, you bump into somebody else that you normally have trouble loving. What do you figure God's saying to you? You can keep on not liking that person? I'm thinking not. That usually means he's doing what? He's trying to hammer a point home to us. And God is aware that we're sort of hard to get through to sometimes. And so what does he do? He just keeps repeating himself. So we get to the 9th chapter and we read, "There is no need for me to write to you about this service to the Lord's people. For I know your eagerness to help." He's already commended them earlier in the letter for that eagerness. "And I have been boasting about it to the Macedonians." And keep in mind, the people of Achaia, where Corinth was, is in the southern part of Greece. And the people he was writing to them about were the people in northern Greece, the Macedonians, telling them that since last year you and Achaia were ready to give, and your enthusiasm has stirred most of them to action. So once again, the enthusiasm and the eagerness of other groups sometimes has a way of doing what? Inspiring us to do just a little bit more, right? It's like when you hear that somebody is doing 5 shoeboxes on their own, and you're only planning on doing maybe one or contributing enough to take care of one. And when you hear that somebody else is doing 5, What does that make you do? Say, man, I wish I had that much money. Or does it make you say, well, do I have that much money, but I'm just not willing to spend it? Right? Sometimes other people's examples of generosity do what for us? When I was in Benton, I was very blessed to have a number of my men in my church and their wives as well who were just exceedingly generous. They were so generous, in fact, their generosity just sort of made me want to be what? More generous, right? And so this is part of the inspiration of seeing great things happen like this. Then you get down to verse 3, but I'm sending the brothers in order that our boasting about you in this matter should not prove hollow. And last week, the final thing I talked about is you need to have more than good intentions when it comes to giving. You need to follow through on those intentions. Because if you don't, all you've got is a bunch of good intentions. That's why it says, but I'm sending the brothers in order that are boasting about you in this matter should not prove hollow, but that you may be ready as I said you would be. For if any Macedonians come with me and find you unprepared, we, not to say anything about you, would be ashamed of having been so confident. This is almost when he's employing just a tad of guilt, maybe. You know, he's tried to appeal to the sacrifice of Christ, and he's appealed to their willingness to give, and now he's going one step further. And none of us ever do that, do we? None of us ever lay a guilt trip on anybody if they don't do something exactly like we want it done, do we? Do we? I'm thinking we're all sort of guilty sometimes. And so Paul does this here. He goes ahead to say, though, in verse 5, so I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to visit you in advance and finish the arrangements for the generous gift you had promised. Then it will be ready as a generous gift, not as one grudgingly given. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So keep in mind that he's already talked to them about their giving. And he's already spoken specifically about the fact that he has been so excited about their willingness and their eagerness to give. Apparently something had happened somewhere along the way, and they hadn't quite followed through yet on what they had promised. And so he's trying to make sure everything is taken care of when they actually do arrive, so all of these matters can be handled in a very nice, pleasant kind of way. So to wrap this up today, there's just three more little things I want to emphasize, the first being this. To excel in the grace of giving, and keep in mind this is what the passage is all about, back in chapter 8 and verse 7, but since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also do what? See that you also excel in the grace of giving. So to excel in the grace of giving, we are to give generously, not grudgingly. Last week I asked us, do we find ourselves being people who are eager and excited to give, or are sometimes we a lot more reluctant than that? When a person finds himself always looking for ways to invest not only their resources, but their time and their talents and their energies to make a difference in the kingdom of God and to make a difference in the hearts and lives of other people, to do that, you normally have to have a spirit that is very generous. I mean, that's what's really required for that to happen. And not only did our Lord and Savior give sacrificially, he gave generously. Now, to me, somebody says, Don, how do you know if you're giving generously? Well, in my way of having studied the scriptures and having been taught all my life what to do, to me, generosity never starts until You're tithing. I don't consider tithing generosity. I consider tithing commanded. And they go, oh. Well, somebody says, well, Jesus didn't say a whole lot about tithing in the New Testament. Well, he said enough. In the Old Testament, they tithe, right? 10%. And the one time Jesus brings up tithing, he brings it up to the religious leaders. He says, now, you people who tithe off of your herb gardens, he was talking to the religious leaders, you tithe on your mint and your dill and your cumin. Now, I call that some pretty deep tithing, don't you all? How many of y'all tithe your gardens? I'm asking, how many of us tithe our gardens to God? Well, somebody says, well, I give away more than 10%. Most people who have a garden do, right? But how many of us really, if we've got a garden, how many of us tithe 10% of it to God? Did Jesus tell them to stop tithing on their herb gardens? No, he didn't tell them to stop doing that. He told them you need to be concerned about what? The more weighty issues of the law than whether you ought to be tithing off the mint and the dill and the cumin. So he never negated tithing at all. That's why I'm thinking, as I read Scripture, generosity doesn't kick in until after the tithe. I don't even think you're giving until after the tithe, because it's his. C.S. Lewis has had a couple things to say about giving, and as you know, C.S. Lewis grew up an Anglican. He didn't grow up in a Southern Baptist church where they preached on tithing all the time. He was the part of the Church of England. And here's what he says about giving. I'm afraid the only safe rule is to give more than we can spare. If our giving habits do not at all pinch or hamper us, I should say they are too small. There ought to be things we want to do but cannot do because our giving expenditures exclude them. Which is his way of saying, if you know you're doing all the things you want to do, you're probably not giving enough. Because sometimes giving really generously and sacrificially means you're not going to do that. He went ahead to say, I do not believe one can settle how much we ought to give. I'm afraid the only safe rule is to give more than we can spare. In other words, if our expenditure on comforts, luxuries, and amusements is up to the standard common among those with a similar income to us, we're probably not giving away enough. That's just one way of looking at it, right? In other words, if you're keeping up with the Joneses, you know, and your goal in life is only to do what? Keep up with the Joneses or the Smiths or whatever the prominent family name is here. We could say the Ramages in this church, right? There's a whole pile of Ramages in the church here. You know, if our job is just to do what? Keep up with everybody else in the same socioeconomic group as us? We're probably not giving away enough. This means you got to really be looking to God and what he wants us to do. Now, to be generous, I do believe we have to follow Paul's advice to the church at Philippi. We're to place the needs of others above our own, and we're always to look to the needs of others first. I believe to really be generous, we have to possess the heart of God. The person who started World Vision, which is one of the hunger organizations that's been very prevalent during my lifetime, somebody asked him what moved him to do this. And he said, it's not the fact that I saw all the hungry people in the world, because he said there's no way to miss the fact that there's hungry people in the world. He says, but when I saw the hungry people of the world and I looked to God, God said to me, I want you to do something about this. He said, this wasn't about me seeing hungry people and wanting to feed them. This was about me looking to God, and God said, I need you to do something about it. And sometimes that's why we have to have a relationship with who? With God. So when we encounter needs every single day, we can discover whether or not we are to do what? To do something about it. You know, it's impossible for one of us to feed all the world, right? But it's not impossible for us to provide food for one other person sometimes, right? Right? Mm-hmm. That's why every day we have opportunities to do what? It's sort of like when you're in the line at McDonald's, right? Has anybody ever paid for your food at McDonald's? Has anybody ever paid for your food at McDonald's? Yes. Have I ever paid for anybody's food at McDonald's? Yes. A couple of times I've regretted it. I didn't really want to be that generous. All I was getting was a Coke and a biscuit, and they got, oh my word, I never knew people ate Big Macs, three Big Macs for breakfast. And you're going, whoops, I picked the wrong one today, right? And sometimes you do it because you look in your rearview mirror, and you know the person behind you. And sometimes you simply do it because you look in the mirror, you don't know that person from anybody, but God says, I want you to do something nice for them today. It's about being what? And when we're generous like that, I love it when I go through the McDonald's line sometimes and they'll say, you're number 7. That means the previous people in front of me, I'm number 7. Everybody has paid for the person's food behind them going through the line. Listen, we have opportunities every day to help people. It's sort of like some people used to come to me and say, hey, Brother Don, we got this family, they need some food. And I said, well, we've got a pantry right here. But sometimes I would say to them, is it something that the church needs to take care of, or is it something that one or two of us can take care of? Because sometimes one or two of us can take care of it. And what are we supposed to do? Somebody says, well, Don, do you think we're supposed to feed the world? Yeah. Do I think we're supposed to share the gospel with everybody? Yeah. Do I think we're to provide a listening ear and a helping hand to anybody that we can? Yeah. And we need to be what when we do this? We need to be generous. I don't know about you all. I find people being generous with me. I mean, my whole life, the only way I've gotten to where I've gotten is people like you taking care of me, right? All my life, I've been taken care of by people just like you. Because you're kind and you're generous and you give. And God, in turn, wants us to do what? He wants us, whether we're writing checks or giving online or reaching into our wallets, He doesn't want us to do this in a begrudging kind of fashion. He wants us to do this generously. I'm sure most all of us have a bucket list, right? Some kind of little list of something that we want to do before we die. I've had a couple things I really want to do, but you know, after I turn 70, I don't know if I really want to do it. I'm serious. I don't know if I really want to do it. That's such a big deal anymore. I don't think it has anything to do with turning 70. Sometimes what you want to do just changes, doesn't it? Sort of hard to peg it. That's why I think at the end of the day, the real bucket list we need to have is our ultimate bucket list. What are we doing right now to store up treasures in heaven? Because at the end of the day, that's all you've got left when you leave this life. I don't care how much money you've amassed, how much property you bought, how many possessions you have. You don't have any of that when you leave this life. All you've got is what you've given and given away. And our Lord and Savior told us we need to be busy doing what? Building up treasures in heaven. And how do you do that? You do it by following His eternal values and investing in the hearts and lives of others. A second thing, to excel in the grace of giving, we're to practice the principle of reaping and sowing, which is a simple agricultural principle that we read about in verse 6. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. I made my way with Carol last Sunday afternoon to East Tennessee to get ready to go watch a golf tournament. And then on Friday, I went to see my other twin play football down in Memphis. And so I got to run through all the way to Dyersburg and then cut through the backwoods to Brownsville, Tennessee to get to Memphis. And the only time I ever get homesick to live in Tennessee again is when I drive through cotton fields, y'all. I grew up in cotton country. We started the school the first week of August. We went to school for 6 weeks, and we got out for 4 to 5 weeks and picked cotton. I didn't grow up on a farm. I grew up in town. But I grew up picking cotton, seeing those fields white unto harvest. Going down Highway 412 right outside of Dyersburg, getting to where you cut through going to Brownsville through the back roads. It is nothing but river bottoms and fields. And I couldn't help but think about all the work that had been done 4, 5, 6 months earlier, because they were out there. Most of the corn in that area had already been harvested. Thousands and thousands of acres I drove by that were already harvested. They were starting to harvest soybeans, and you can see the dust flying all over the place out in the middle of the field, and just a couple of the cotton fields had been picked. Lord willing, and I live till Friday, I will go to Memphis again to see my grandson play his last home football game, and I'm looking forward to that, but I'm really looking forward to seeing those cotton fields a little bit whiter. And there's nothing like the fields being white into harvest when you grew up there, and that's part of your background. You all are into tobacco plants here, okay? Y'all are into tobacco plants. I'm sorry, I'm into cotton plants, because that's just the crop that was the main crop back in those days. But I know one thing, the only reason they're harvesting all those crops right now is because they did not sow sparingly. They sowed generously, they sowed liberally, and because they did, they are now reaping an unbelievable harvest. Sometimes you go to the mailbox, and sometimes you really hope for, you know, like real correspondence. Really not as much anymore, since we correspond in different kind of ways. I know sometimes I'd go to the mailbox and said, you know, I just never get a personal letter from anybody. I wonder why that is. And you know why that was? Did I ever write anybody a personal letter? Did I ever write anybody a personal letter? Why no? Well, why should I expect somebody else to write me a letter if I hadn't written them a letter? And nowadays we don't write letters. Nowadays we get on our what? Our phone. And we text. Or we do whatever we do. I'm still not to those higher levels of communication. I think I'm still texting and occasional email. So I know that is dark ages, you know, 14 centuries ago, according to most technological people. But I know one thing. If I text enough people, what happens? Somebody texts me back. That's what I always tell people. If you've emailed me or texted me and I haven't responded in a little while, you may not have gotten me, or it went to junk. For some reason, a lot of time people send me email and it goes to junk. So I tell people, if you're going to send me an important email, text me too. That way I'll know it went to junk when I don't see it. Because sometimes you need to see those things. The key for all of us in the middle of this, though, is if you sow sparingly, what's going to happen? I mean, if you don't text anybody, you're not going to get texted back. If you don't email anybody, nobody's going to email you back. And sometimes what we learn as we read people's, quote-unquote, means of correspondence, you learn something about people's hearts, right? David McCullough is an excellent historical writer. And a few years back, I read his book about John Adams. And John Adams and his wife, even though they had to spend a whole bunch of their life apart because of the work he was doing in the Revolutionary War, they kept most of their letters. And their letters really reveal the great heart they had for one another and the great heart they had as well for who? For the country that they were really trying to make a difference for. That's why if you really want to see people's hearts sometimes, listen to what they say, and more importantly, if they're corresponding with you in some way, see what they're talking about. Because the more you're around people, the more you learn what's important and what's vital and what's essential and what is necessary. This is why if we sow sparingly with regards to investing our hearts and lives, not just from the standpoint of money, but from the standpoint of investing our hearts and lives in the development of other people, you're not going to reap very much. That's why it's so vitally important for every one of us to do what? To be people who invest in the people all around us. Because when we do this, this is showing generosity in the investment of our time and in the investment of our energy. Sometimes I have to ask even myself, God, am I really giving you my best? Am I just giving you this little bit of time I've carved out for you early in the morning? Am I really being generous this kind of way? And this is why the Lord, we quickly learn if we're not sowing in a very abundant kind of way, we're not going to reap very much. And then one final thing in this passage. To excel at the grace of giving, we are to cheerfully give as God directs us. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give. In other words, you make that decision. Not reluctantly, not under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. You know, the joke has always been, God loves a cheerful giver, but he'll take from a grouch. I've heard it ever since I was a little kid. Once again, I grew up in a Baptist church. They talked a lot about tithing in the Baptist church when I was growing up. I got tickled with some of my Church of Christ friends one time in Benton. They were asking me, Don, you all seem to be able to get your people to give more money than we do. And I said, here's the difference. I said, you all tell people if they miss church on Sunday, they're going to hell. We tell them if they don't tithe, they're going to hell. And this guy looked at me like I was nuts. And then I laughed. I was clowning with him. But I said, it's what we emphasize, right? If you stress something enough, people sort of say, okay, this is something that we really need to do and we really need to be a part of. That's why when you turn back over to 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verses 1 and 2, here's how he instructed them to give. Now, about the collection for the Lord's people, which is what he's talking about here, they were collecting funds to take care of people back in Judea and in that part of the world, the Middle East, who were going through a famine and a drought and who needed some help. Now, about the collection for the Lord's people, do what I told the Galatian churches to do. In other words, this is what Paul had been instructing all the believers to do. On the first day of every week, which is Sunday, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income, saving it up so that when I come, no collection will have to be made. In other words, if you do this as you go, then we don't have to have this giant offering to get everything done and taken care of. You know, as a Baptist preacher, I've always wanted to have what happened to the Hebrew children in the wilderness to happen in a Baptist church. You know, they took up an offering to build the tabernacle in the wilderness. And guess what Moses had to do? It's exactly right. And so far, I've yet to ever do that. Right? I mean, they said, back off. We've got more than enough. Now, most of those people had been slaves in Egypt. Where'd they get all this stuff from? They'd been slaves in Egypt. Where'd they get all this stuff from? They plundered the Egyptians before they left, right? Correct? They asked all their Egyptian neighbors, oh, please, give us a going away present. And that's how they got everything. When you read how David built the temple, or David, he never got to build it, Solomon did, but how David took up an offering for the temple, what did David do for a living? He was a shepherd. Then he became a warrior. Then he became a king. Where did David get all that money, or all that gold, to finance the building of the temple? From all the countries around him that he had done what to? Defeated and conquered. In other words, who paid for the building of the tabernacle? And who paid for the building of the temple? Was it God's people? No. It was financed by the evil one. That's right, isn't it, Miss Ruby? It was financed. She was shaking her head. You got that right. I hadn't thought about that. That's who financed it. Don't tell me God can't do what he wants to do and control what he wants to control and make happen what he wants to make happen. And he can do it in ways that absolutely confounds us. So he simply says to us, on the first day of every week, do what? You just set aside a sum of money as I give you guidance and direction to do so according to what you make. You see, it's never about equal gifts. It's about everybody sacrificing, right? It's always about equal sacrifice. Paul had established the pattern, the protocol, the manner in which they were to go about doing this, and he didn't want anybody doing it under compulsion. He didn't want anybody being forced to do this. You know, there's some churches that assess their members. Y'all know that, don't you? Some other groups. They tell people in their particular areas how much you are going to give. Do we do that in Baptist churches? No, never have. It's all about people making their own decisions in their own lives about what they're going to do and how they're going to follow through on this. Even though Paul had laid out some positive reasons for them to do what they were going to do, you know, he finally gets a little guilt-tripping it in this passage to make sure they followed through on it. Let me just read the rest of the passage for you, because the rest of the passage just sort of sums it all up. And God is able, in verse 8, to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Listen to this one more time. And God is able, man, when you give like this, God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things and at all times, having all that you need, you will be bound in every good work, as it is written. They have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. In other words, as we give, it's actually expressing our gratitude for all that he has done for us and how he provides for us. Because of the service by which you have provided yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession. In other words, when we give generously, it does inspire other people. It moves other people to be generous in the same way. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. To excel in the grace of giving, we're to give generously, not grudgingly. We simply need to practice sowing and reaping in a generous kind of way. And we need to give cheerfully, not under force or under compulsion. Last week I mentioned a prayer for you that we prayed as part of our capital campaign, but it's just a great prayer to pray all the time. Lord, what do you want to do through me to accomplish your will for High Point Church? One more time. Lord, what do you want to do through me to accomplish your will for High Point Church? As we open ourselves up to God's leadership and guidance, He always provides us the direction and the way to go. And as we find ourselves giving as He desires for us to give, He promises us something really great. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything that you need will be provided for you. I'm here to tell you, my parents taught me to tithe when I was a little kid. When I got ready to go to college, my dad pulled me aside about a year before I went to college and said, Donnie, I was able to pay my way through college. And I just want you to know you're going to pay your way through college too. I started with to say, Daddy, I wish you had told me that like 10 years earlier. I'd have been more diligent in my savings. But I'd always saved a little money. And I went, okay. He says, because your sister's going the next year, and we're not going to have enough money to pay for both of y'all to go to college. But my mom and my dad sat me down and said, God has called you to preach. And He has told us, if you will seek my kingdom and my righteousness first, I will provide every need for you. It had been a whole lot cheaper if I went to UT Martin. I could have gone to UT Martin for 4 years for what I went to Union for 1 year. But I felt led to go to Union. I was studying for the ministry. I borrowed, it sounds so minuscule now. You could get national defense loans then. I think I was supposed to have gotten like $500 for the first year, which I know sounds like chicken feed, but in 1970, it was not chicken feed. So the first semester, I got $250. And the second semester, I didn't take the $250 because I had enough money to pay for everything. I'd gotten a little scholarship, but I'd also worked and had a good job that my father had gotten for me. And even at the end of the year, when people say, don't pay your student loans back, I went ahead and paid my student loan off of a whopping $250 at the end of my freshman year. And my parents kept reminding me, Donnie, if you'll just seek the kingdom of the Lord first and His righteousness, He'll take care of you. And I'm here to tell you, I am now 71 years old. And He's never not kept His promise. Now, there's been a time or two I probably overextended just a touch. I remember Carol and I bought a mattress one time. We thought we had the $120 to buy the mattress. You say, man, it was a lousy mattress. Wasn't that lousy? We slept on it for 25 years, didn't we, hon? I mean, that's all we could afford. And then something else happened, and we were out of money. And I'll never forget, it was the month of May. We were just out of money. I was a seminary student. I really didn't know how we were going to buy groceries that week. And my grandmother in Nashville, Tennessee, sent me a check for about $20 in the mail to come home on in July, which was all we needed for that week. I promise y'all, if you follow him and do what he tells you to do, he will meet your needs according to his riches in glory. You're not going to probably have a lake house, but that's not what you need. I'm not driving the Cadillac, but that's not what I need. Listen, seek him first. I can't stress it enough. Seek him first, do his will, make his will a priority, and he'll do what for you? He will take care of you. And all we can do is say, thank you, Lord, for being so good to all of us. And that's what he'll do. But you got to seek him first. If you aren't seeking him first, it is my prayer today, you will begin to do that. There may be public decisions that need to be made today. We simply encourage your response today. As we stand to sing our hymn, I think it's Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. 309, something like that. 308, I'm not too far away. 308. We encourage you to respond today as we stand to sing. Don't forget the meeting following the service for anybody interested in being a part of helping with the extension group here at church. We love you, Father. We thank you for the day you've given to us. We thank you for this opportunity we've had to come into your presence and worship together. It's always a joy, Father, to be with God's people and to lift up your name. Thank you for meeting our needs according to your riches and glory. Thank you as well for not giving up on us. Thank you for your patience with us. And Father, just move in our hearts and lives to be willing to do whatever it is that you call us to do. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.